Nobody likes getting a flat battery, and race cars are famous for always having some small electrical device fitted that's constantly draining just enough charge from your battery to ensure that next time you go to start the engine, all you're going to hear is that dreaded click from your starter motor solenoid. It's one of the reasons, along with the huge safety benefits they provide, that we fit battery isolators to race cars. Traditionally, battery isolators have been a mechanical device in the form of a large switch with a big red key. Now these do work, but they require you to run the large main power feed cables to a location within easy reach of the driver. Often this isn't convenient or practical. The isolator we're going to look at here is a solid state isolator, and that means all of its switching is done with electronics. There are no moving parts, and you can remotely control the device from a much smaller, more conveniently mounted low current switch. It also allows for an emergency switch to be mounted on the exterior of the vehicle. This allows a race warden to kill the electrical system in the case of an accident. Solid-state battery isolators are not a particularly new development, but I'm really excited to have a look at the one offered by Motorsport Electronics, as it includes CAN bus communications, which allows the device to be more configurable and to give you feedback as to the current being drawn from or supplied to the battery. This replaces the need for a traditional alternator warning system and can even let you know if your alternator is only beginning to fail, as you'll be able to log the current it's supplying, compare this between various race outings, and it'll give you an idea of whether its efficiency is starting to fall off. So without any more preamble, we'll open up this box and have a look inside. So we can see it comes in a fairly nondescript white box, which if we open up, straight away we've got some documentation on top. My love of printed documentation is well known because it is super handy when your laptop battery has gone flat. We've got a wiring diagram here, which I'm going to come back to and discuss in a bit of detail, as there's a really important point I want to make about the alternator connection in a traditional battery isolator system. On the back here, we've got some information as to maximum and minimum electrical supply currents and voltages. Temperature ratings, and there is a QR code you can scan which will get you access to the full user manual. It was also pretty easy to find the full user manual on Motorsport Electronics website. Inside here we have information on the installation and switch connections. There's an LED on the front of the device, which is a nice multicolor LED, and they've made really good use of all its different colors to provide you with feedback as to the current state of the device. So if it's gone into any warning modes, you'll be able to look at the flashing color code and determine what's happened. It also outputs all those warning modes over CAN bus, so you'll be able to set up your ECU or data logging system to interface to that, and it could display what the current mode of the battery isolator is. We've got power distribution ECU connections, so that is one of the pins on the device is what's known as a logical output, and when I come to talk about that wiring diagram, we'll have a talk about how this affects this setup as well. So we've also got our CAN bus output data format. That's going to be the key information you're going to need to configure your ECU or logging system to read the information the device is sending out. So you'll be able to get all these statuses, the voltage seen at both the input and the output of the isolator, and the current flowing through the isolator, and which direction it's flowing, if it's going into or out of the battery. So we've also got a DTM six-way connector here. Now we've been supplied with a DTM six-way connector, as we've optioned the version of the device that has a flying lead and a DTM connector on it. It is also available in a version that has a mil-spec connector. We haven't gone for that because the DTM connection is more appropriate for the electrical system we've got fitted to the vehicle we're going to put this in, which is our 350Z race car. So getting to the device itself, it comes protected in a little bit of bubble wrap. That's always nice, as we really hate for things to get damaged by couriers, and bagged up. So we'll break our way in here, and we can now have a look at the device itself. So you can see we've got the flying lead version of the device here. So this is going to be nice Tefzel wire in here. It's been sheathed in Raychem DR25. And they've gone with SCL for the booting method, so that's going to be really nice and rigid and well strain relieved. Where it connects to the device, they've used a Hallerman boot, and you can see how it would have worked if we had optioned the version of the device that had the mil-spec connector. That would have actually just protruded directly from the device here. So they must be using a custom adapter to accept this Hellermann boot, which was going to strain relieve everything and ensure the connections in there are going to be nice and reliable. We've got our input and output studs here. So this is where our main battery connection is going to be made from our battery positive. And this is going to be the output connection to the rest of the vehicle electronics. Those are M6 copper coated studs. So although they look like they're copper and they'd be really easy to strip, they're not. They are just copper coated. That's going to give you the electrical conductivity you need, but also the longevity if you're removing or installing these nuts often. Nice to see that they've given us Nylock nuts, so once they're installed they're not going to be able to rattle loose, and some insulation caps to go on top of those. The construction of the housing itself, it's a flat plate on the bottom here, and it'll be a CNC machined upper housing. We've got four fasteners on the bottom here, which looks like it's how they've assembled it, but there definitely wouldn't be anything serviceable in here, so you'd never have any need to undo those. And I suspect even if you did, the device is probably completely potted inside, so you wouldn't be able to disassemble it. Two mounting ears here. The base plate is reasonably thin, and those don't look incredibly robust, but if you're mounting it to a flat surface, they're definitely going to be more than adequate. I wouldn't want to go mounting this to anything that's got any sort of irregularities on it though, as I suspect you'd probably bend them quite easily. Got the status LED that we mentioned before on the front here. So that's going to be really handy if the device is mounted in a visible area. If it's not, you've obviously got access to all the information that you get from that status LED over the CAN bus network as well. Now earlier on I mentioned there was a really important point that I wanted to make in regards to alternator wiring when you're installing an isolator system in a vehicle. If we think of this as a traditional isolator system, so that would be a mechanical switch with the big red key, and we wired it up as shown here, that would be the battery connected to just the input stud of that mechanical switch, and the alternator starter motor and rest of the electrical system connected to the output stud. If the engine was running and the alternator was supplying current to the battery and the rest of the electrical system, and you came and turned that mechanical switch off, separating the battery from the vehicle, from the rest of the electrical system, it wouldn't actually kill the electrical system in the vehicle because the alternator will continue to supply the current required by the rest of the electronics, so it won't disable the engine. That's a reasonably dangerous situation to get into because you've expected the engine to die when you've disconnected that switch, and it hasn't. But even worse than that is that you've just disconnected the battery from the electrical system of a running vehicle, and that will cause a situation known as a load dump spike. What happens there is that the current that the alternator is supplying can no longer use the battery as a reservoir because the battery has been disconnected. So it will continue to supply a large current for a short but appreciable amount of time, and that large current will cause a very large voltage spike, which the rest of your electronics in the vehicle will see, and it's extremely common for them to be damaged by this. Now, the isolator supplied by Motorsport Electronics does show you to wire it up in this potentially damaging way, but they have been able to do that because I've included some clever smarts in the device that prevent a load dump spike from being able to occur. Now, the way it does this is by providing you with a logical output wire that you run to either your ECU or your power distribution module. If the low current switches get triggered, which is commands the battery isolator to disconnect the battery from the circuit, the first thing it does is use that logical wire to tell your ECU or power distribution module to kill the engine. Because the isolator is always monitoring the current flowing between these two pins, it knows when the engine shut off and the alternator is no longer supplying current to the battery, and it's therefore safe to isolate the battery from the circuit. You can use commands sent over the CAN bus network to configure the battery isolator for the maximum amount of delay it will introduce into the system. So if it doesn't detect that the engine has been killed after, say, 5 seconds, it will disconnect the battery regardless. This is a really crucial safety feature. Some other interesting things on the wiring diagram here. You can see it's got a facility for an external switch, so that's a switch mounted on the exterior of the vehicle, which is a normally closed momentary switch. They use a normally closed switch for this, as it means if the vehicle's in a serious accident and this wire gets severed, it'll no longer be connected to ground, and that's the same as actually pressing the switch. So a serious enough accident will cause the electrical system of the vehicle to be disconnected. The driver switch is a normally open latching switch, and that'd be the main switch the driver would use to either enable the main power of the vehicle or disable it when your race day is over, for example. They've also shown our CAN bus communication connections here, so that's a twisted pair, and they've used a reasonably common colour code of green for CAN low and yellow for CAN high. They've shown external termination resistors fitted, as it does say in the main user manual documentation that the device doesn't include any termination resistors, which, given the option, it's always nice if a device doesn't have termination resistors, as I really like to be able to choose where I put those in the wiring harness. Continuing on with the CAN bus side of things, Motorsport Electronics have gone an interesting way with the configuration of the device. It's a pretty expensive process to go through to create a software suite to configure devices like this, and they've done it a different way. Instead, you configure its settings by sending it specially formatted CAN bus messages. Now, that might initially seem a little bit cumbersome, but the reality is any vehicle you're going to be fitting this to and utilizing its CAN bus communication facilities in is most likely going to have other electronics installed in the vehicle that are capable of generating custom CAN commands. Now, the full user manual does have a detailed guide on how you generate these custom commands to configure the device. Various things you can configure are the parameter ID that the device will transmit on, the CAN bus communication speed it will transmit at, and the logical setting of the output pin that you run to either your PDU or ECU to kill the engine. You can either have it switch high, switch low, or enable and disable pull-ups. Looking at the device on the bench here, there is an option I would have liked to have seen, and that would be to have a right-angled boot on the flying lead connection here, probably orientated so it was coming out of the top of the device. The amount of space required here is actually quite large to avoid needlessly straining this flying lead. So it's just something we'll have to take into account when we're fitting this into the vehicle. Now, on that front, we are actually going to be fitting this battery isolator into our Nissan 350Z race car, as the battery isolation system in at the moment is somewhat suboptimal, and it has given us a few issues. That car also has a slight fault with the alternator, which I've been slightly dragging my heels on fixing, as I really want to get some data out of the car before and after I fix the problem to see the differences, which this device is really going to let me dial in on with its CAN bus communications and being able to see exactly how much current is flowing from the alternator to the battery. If you'd like to see more of that installation process in our 350Z race car, keep an eye on our social media channels, because we will be doing an installation video when that goes ahead. That's the Motorsport Electronics battery isolator. It's a nice, tidy little package, quite lightweight, looks very robust, and I can't wait to get it installed in the vehicle.